Do you know what the number one universal fear among people is? Did you catch that?
Public speaking.
Number one is public speaking. So I stand before you terrified. But seriously, public speaking, statistically, it's a greater fear than fear of death. The doors were locked. Why did they lock the doors? Doors were locked for fear of the Jews. All right? This is Resurrection Day. This is 2 days after the crucifixion. They were scared. They were afraid they would suffer the same fate as Jesus. And he stood in their midst and twice blessed them with peace bringing. In the first reading, now this is weeks later, the ascension has taken place. And the group of believers is gathered again once more. There's no mention of locked doors this time. There's no mention of fear, but they may very well have been afraid and certainly bewildered. What do we do now? What are we supposed to do with this? There's no mention of fear. But I know if I had been there and suddenly heard the sound of a strong driving wind filling the house, I'd be a little frightened. And I know if I looked up and saw a flame on Tracy's head. You got one too. A little bit unsettling. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit. And in a slightly different translation, I'm just a little more familiar with this, they began to make bold proclamations in many languages as the Spirit prompted them. Just like that, they were able to overcome the most universal of human fears. And they began to speak the faith. Now that's Acts chapter 2, and it's worth reading it. This passage ended. But what happens next is these folks who were at first confused and then astounded and amazed, trying to make sense of this. This is right in the scriptures. They respond, what's going on? They're ordinary Galileans. They've had too much wine. Peter responds, it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. As if to say, we don't drink until 5 o'clock. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. And Peter begins to tell the story of Jesus with emphasis on resurrection from the dead. And it's so compelling that as he gives this great account, the response is, well, what are we supposed to do? And he says, be baptized and reform your lives. And the passage goes on to say, that day, 3,000 were added to their number and were baptized. Filled with fear, suddenly bold. And folks were confused. amazed. And you know, there's still some there. As you'll hear in the intercessions today, later today, in two different settings, I'll have the joy and privilege of baptizing two adults. But what will you have? They shared the faith. For a few years now, the diocese and the Church of ours has really been emphasizing evangelization. Share your faith. Welcome folks. Folks who've been away, welcome them back. Reach out. Now I know how difficult it is to do that. But consider this. These frightened characters, suddenly emboldened, folks were taken. We speak our faith even without words. You see, people notice. They don't often say much, but people notice when you avoid certain language. People notice when you speak up for sense, when the rhetoric gets a little wild and crazy. People notice when the gossip is hot and heavy, tearing somebody to shreds. They notice that you keep your mouth shut. Or maybe even say something nice about the victim. People notice when you're in a restaurant and very subtly make the sign of the cross. And pray a little prayer. Or maybe it's a little bit like the maybe it's just a bowed head in silence. I've certainly noticed how waitresses recognize that. They'll wait a moment. You know, if our faith is limited to an hour on Sundays, it's a pretty pathetic faith. We live our faith. Not perfectly, but we live our faith. And people notice. But what do you think? What would you say to the person next to you about your faith? I know that's not an easy thing to do, and I would never ask you to actually do it, except that it's Pentecost, and I will. So seriously, turn to somebody near you and say something about your faith. Here I come, here and now.
Peace be with you. God bless you.
Same to you. God bless you.
I've had a little practice with this, that earlier message, you know. And as I've said twice before, my faith is my name. I don't live my days filled with dread and anxiety, but I have to do this public speaking. But every once in a while, there are real challenges and real difficulties. My faith is my anchor. wondering about what happens. What's next? My faith is my anchor. Mary Ann said, God has been very good to me. There are ways of sharing our faith. As simple as saying, oh, you should have been at St. Rita last weekend. Or this is a good one. I had the most amazing meal on Sunday morning. Oh, really? Where'd you go? St. Rita. Oh, really? Did they have a meal? Well, yeah. It's called the Eucharist. He shared in the body and blood of Christ. There's something to say that, oh, I'll pray for you. Let me do it right now. There's such simple ways of sharing our faith without being in your face, finger pointing, even uncomfortable. Too many times, we let fear stifle us. Too many times we imagine that folks will think we're weird if we actually say, I like going to church because it's such a gift. It's such a strength, it's such a nourishment, it's such a support. Well, fear is real. It's part of our human experience. We might do our best to quell our fears, to rise above them. We might do our best to claim that, oh, I'm never afraid of anything. But it's a part of the human experience. And so is the power of the Holy Spirit poured out on us. Take advantage of that gift. Be ready to confuse some folks. Be ready to astound, to amaze them with a simple gesture of faith, the simple assurance, the simple willingness to keep your language clean, to be encouraging rather than critical. To say thanks when nobody bothers. The Holy Spirit is for real. Savor this precious gift. May God bless us all.